might be interested in the paper, in this paper, might want to download it from our website. So it's available.
Yes. All the presentations.
For the presentation.
We will.
Including the ones.
Yes.
Well, this is a long paper. If you read the original, has two case studies. And this is the reason why Mr. Domingo of Quezon City Local Government is here. Because we featured the, some of the reforms in Quezon City government in the paper. It's a case study. The other case study is the National Competitiveness Council. Originally, we invited the NCC to be here, but fortunately, they couldn't come because they also have a similar activity, I think, today. But you might be interested to take a look at what the national government has been doing in the private sector and what local governments, like Quezon City government, have been doing to improve regulatory quality in the country. So this paper, this presentation, is the outline of the presentation. So we take a look at the need for regulatory quality, and that is very simple. The policy and regulatory reform and challenges, establishing a formal regulatory management system, an assessment of the Philippine RMS, and some policy recommendations. This will be just a very brief presentation in the interest of time. There are three others. Just want to convey the message that it's about time that we should be looking at okay. Technology. So we are signatory to the ASEAN Economic Community 2015, and our commitment is to improve overall business and economic environment. And part of this environment would be efficient regulation. So the research, we look at the research globally, and we saw how countries have tried to improve their system of regulations. They have used such words as cutting down the regulatory burden. It's a way to improve the business environment. That's precisely what national and local government agencies have been trying to do, to improve regulatory quality. And I trust that the three other presenters will bring us to this particular issue when the third comes. So there are fundamental action that we need to do here. We need to improve domestic regulatory quality and coherence. Now, we are a signatory to this AEC economic community, and we need to address two issues. One would be what we call the border issues. This border issues pertain to tariffs, to trade facilitation. One particular mechanism to facilitate trade is national single window, which we can discuss some other time. The other side of the commitment looks at domestic, what we call behind the border issues, meaning domestic, internal. And an important part of this internal issue should be regulations, which affect you and me. This morning, it took me 2.5 hours to get here. Sheer volume of vehicles. Some say it's partly because of the effect of progress. We've been developing quite fast relative to other neighbors, and we'll see the numbers. It's also because of the need to improve regulatory systems in the transportation sector. So the paper highlights the critical measures to reduce the cost of doing business in the country. We examine the case of reducing regulatory burden and improving regulatory quality in the Philippines. First, what is regulation? Well, there are various definitions. Some would be very comprehensive, like that of Gil, who would use this to cover not just the regulations issued by government agencies, but also include, he will also include primary laws, meaning laws passed by Congress, secondary regulations, or even tertiary rules. So the business permit, licenses that businessmen seek from local government units will belong to the latter category, tertiary rules. secondary regulations would be in Hill's taxonomy would include those issued by government regulatory bodies. In our example here, Marina, the PFRB, Papua New Guinea. So OECD has this very comprehensive definition. Any instrument which will cover, encompass a wide range of actions. This will be what also including administrative formalities and decisions. The Philippine context, in the paper, we chose to limit the discussion on rules, permits, and licenses issued, controlled, and implemented by the national government, local governments, and regulatory bodies. We didn't take a look at the mandate that, on the laws passed by Congress, because it will make the paper very unwieldy. Maybe in some future time, we'll have to look at the laws passed. But for the meanwhile, we say, let's take a look at the regulations, the permits and licenses which affect our daily lives. These are those issued basically by the executive branch. And one reason is, okay, we may be able to suggest ways to improve regulatory quality, and it can be done because issuances are done by the executive body. Now, why do we need regulatory quality? But first, we have to understand, okay, what's the purpose of the regulation, and it's to influence or direct cognitive and behavioral changes in consumers and firms. For example, we want to, let's say, address health issues, so there could be a regulation banning smoking in public places. We want to constrain particular behaviors of consumers. It's all for upholding public interest and the general welfare. That seems to be the overriding concern with respect to issuing regulation, not to restrict the movement or behavior of consumers and firms per se, but really to ensure that public interest and the welfare of the public is upheld. Sometimes we agree with me, there could be poor regulations which could undermine business confidence and competitiveness, and which will erode public trust in government. Now, let's take a look at some numbers and graphs just to show regulatory quality among ASEAN member states. Philippines would be this one, the green one, and the topmost would be the Singapore. So that's Singapore. That's the benchmark in the region. It's the most efficient country with respect to regulation. This one would be Malaysia, and Thailand will be the blue one, blue, and Philippines is there. At the bottom of the heap would be Vietnam. So we are in the middle. But we could probably have risen to higher level. That's Thailand. Try nothing yet. Now let's look at some governance indicators. This is just with respect to Philippines. This will be made available to you, so I just want to highlight regulatory quality. That's regulatory quality. So mas mataas yung government effectiveness. Now, let's take a step back to some history, late 80s, 2000, because people might say nothing has changed. That's not quite correct, because government, especially some past administrations, have really introduced quite a number of reforms, regulatory reforms in the country. And in many ways, we are benefiting from the reforms because in the past. And the main benefit can be gauged in terms of the economic growth. We'll discuss that later. So, under Ms. Aquino, we had greater openness of the economy and more vigorous trade liberalization. The reliance on private enterprise as the main engine of growth. So, we had what? The result now, if we look now, what would the result of this, results of these reforms? Well, we have lower rate of inflation because we have liberalized trade. So we have been able to bring in foodstuffs at a lower price, and that has been accessible to a lot of people, and that has contributed to lowering of inflation. So food is within reach of many of our people. And that's because government in the past said we'll have to embrace this trade liberalization. At that time, the reform was not popular. There are a lot of, several interests going against the reform. And that's understandable. But now we can see the result. Now, in the case of Mr. Ramos, he introduced reforms, it's not stated here, but I could mention telecommunications, water privatization. So we have benefited from the reforms in terms of more households having access to safe and clean potable water. Telecoms has improved, but they need to improve a lot more. And other regulatory reforms, if you take a look, I'll give you a particular reform, general banking law of 2000, and with that also the reform creating the Banco Central de Filipinas. Under the general banking law, government for the first time recognized microfinance as mainstream finance. So it's not 5-6, it's not informal lending, it's microfinance. You're not familiar by this time. At that time, it was a bold reform introduced. People were saying microfinance, microcredit should be subsidized, so on and so forth. But the result of this is the flowering of the microfinance industry. We are, I think, with Peru, one of the two top countries in the world with respect to microfinance. And microfinance has created access to liquidity, access to loans for a great number of poor households. So you can see the reforms are bearing fruit. At the time when the reforms are being produced, some people resisted. Now we see the results. Even Gloria Arroyo, as Arroyo, introduced Anti-Red Tape Act in 2007. So, and we can go down the line. I will not dwell on the regulatory reform momentum weekend. Everybody knows about it. If governance is weak and poor, then the momentum stops or even ends with negative results. Now, quick rundown on comparative economic performance. So we try to show the 2010-2015, and you will note that course Philippines, compared to the rest of the ASEAN, we are doing very fine. So even in 2015, this year, we expect 6.4 GDP growth, although last quarter, I think we managed 5.6%, I'm not mistaken. I'm almost done, so just going through this. Let's take a look at some of the reforms in reducing doing business. Track one in Manila, okay, that was addressed. And then in dealing with construction permits, the government eliminated the requirement to obtain a health certificate. So, communication paying taxes, introduced an electronic filing and payment system. This one is the Quezon City local government. So the old process, 34 days, but because of their work, hard work in Quezon City, the process can be completed in 8 days. It's quite a feat, no? And it took a lot of effort, a lot of coordination amongst the various units to achieve the reform. So this just summarizes how you do it now. And here are the logos of the agencies which had to participate. So what we can see here is not reforming regulation is not easy. It's not a walk in the park, so to speak. In many ways, you would have to deal with a number of government agencies. And the key there is effective coordination. But interested in the Philippines ranking global competitiveness report card, we're doing fine in many, and your ranking as a group, but there are still work in progress. Okay. Let me just look at this. Now, the interest in forming, establishing a formal regulatory system arose in the OECD countries because they've been bogged down by regulation. So they found that, you know, they really bound their hands, they could not move, firms are complaining, cost of doing business is high, and therefore they have to untangle the nuts, all these things that bind them, and those are regulations. So they thought that a formal regulatory management system can help, and this will consist of reducing regulatory burden on citizens and firms, make a conscious effort to improve regulatory quality, and identify the best choice of policy options. Now, there are four elements. First, you need regulatory quality tools. Then you need a process. Then you need an institution, and you need good regulatory policies. Let's take a look at the case of Malaysia. So they're quite a systematic way of doing it. This is the public-private, the MUDA, similar to our NCC. So the PEMUDA takes care of, okay, what things to reform, and then they shuttle the reforms to a number of agencies. So they draft a law, and the cabinet will make a decision, parliament and enforcement. So the system is captured in this slide. We call this the regulatory impact statement process. So first you need to publish a regulator has to notify the Malaysian Productivity Corporation. They want to introduce a regulation. Then they do a needs assessment. So they study very well. Do you need this regulation? They just don't issue a regulation. They would have to apply post notice to the Malaysian Productivity Corporation, do a needs assessment. If they need to do this, they undertake what they call a regulatory impact analysis. So what do you do there with the RIA? Well, you would have to weigh the costs and benefits of the regulation. You would have to show how the regulation will be implemented. And if there are costs to it, okay, they would have to show the cost. So it's a very systematic process. Then there's a review. Submission to another government body until it goes to the decision maker, and finally you publish the regulatory impact statement. Now, of course, people might say, well, that's very bureaucratic. Imagine you have to go through this process. But I tell you, we are indirect, maybe I mean our team here, because we're working with a number of countries on developing such regulatory management systems in our respective countries. And we talked with the Malaysian Productivity Corporation staff and employees, and they showed us how really this has helped businesses in their country. They've cut down the number of days to obtain a license, they've cut down the number of signatories, they've cut down on the paperwork. Now, one might say, how do you measure regulatory burden? Now, there is a forthcoming project on how to measure regulatory burden, and the PIDS will participate in that project. Just to give an example of how countries around the world measure this, in the case of Australia, one crude measure would be the number of pages of a given regulation. It's that simple. So, and I saw, okay, they gave an example of a regulation in Australia. They said, this is about 30 pages of regulations, and that would be a burden for firms to comply. So each type of regulation would require certain forms to fill, how many forms, how many pages, and all of those. So that's one way to capture regulatory burden. We'll do a more systematic capturing. I'm just trying to tell you what happens next after this endeavor. Okay, this one, Philippines. What do we have? Well, we have the four elements of a regulatory formal regulatory management system, and we say, well, we have regulatory policies. We have regulatory institutions, Marina, LPFRB, local government. We have regulatory procedures. There is a call for a public consultation. There's always this desire to inform the public, get reaction, where affected stakeholders present position papers. And there are regulatory tools, some probably draft cost-benefit analysis. But what we saw in the paper is that is not string together into a formal regulatory management system. Unlike what we showed here, where there is really a formal, systematic way of assessing the need for a regulation. In our case, we do this individually. So each regulatory body would have to do this on its own. Now, I'm not saying in the paper that we should have this one. I'm not saying that we should copy this. It may work for Malaysia, but in the case of the Philippines, we still don't know. We need to do further studies. But definitely, what we need would be a systematic way of reviewing, assessing regulations. It's about time that we take a look at all the regulations that each and every other regulatory institution has amassed or compiled through the years, do a review, and shed, cut away those which are unnecessary. In other countries, and I just forgot to put the slide here, Vietnam. Vietnam is doing this, and they call this putting the regulations under a regulatory guillotine. That's a term they use. And by the way, that term is copyrighted by consultant Mr. Jacobs and Associates. Every time you use regulatory guillotine, you have to say that it's copyrighted and it's burned. So it's a trademark and copyrighted, so I'm saying it because we're doing live streaming. So regulatory guillotine, just a graphic way of saying that you need to cut down on a good number of regulations to free up the environment so that businesses will find it conducive to do business. And Vietnam has been very effective at that. In fact, if you compare the inflows of foreign direct investments, compare those coming to Vietnam and coming to the Philippines, maybe one explanatory variable show the difference. Vietnam has a bigger inflow, one explanatory variable could be this way they treat their own regulatory. Their own regulations. So, this is what we say in the paper. We need we have a public-private task force on Philippine competitiveness, and this has morphed into the National Competitiveness Council. They're doing quite a job in trying to reduce cost of doing business, but. Second bullet says, Philippine regulators are neither required to undertake regulatory impact analysis nor issue regulatory impact statements. Because issuing regulatory impact statements will require you to tell the public if this is the likely effect on firms and consumers of this regulation. So you have to weigh costs and benefits. Now, there is general interest world over in regulatory impact analysis. OECD countries have been doing this for a long time. Now, it's come to us that we probably would need to do this. And there are three pilot RIA projects, all funded by the Asian Development Bank. One is a part of the labor employment, the other one is in tourism, and the other one is in the NEDA. The NEDA wants to develop capacity to undertake regulatory impact analysis of government regulations. Now, what are the challenges? Well, we need to develop our skills and knowledge in analyzing the impacts of regulation. It's not easy. Just doing calculating the costs and benefits, it's not easy. There's a science to it, but it's not easy. We have to learn it. And we have to strengthen coordination across ministries. If you recall, in one slide, I pointed out that just addressing a particular regulation could mean talking to a number of government agencies, coordinate them so that they are on the same page. And then a weak interface between government and business, but this one would qualify, maybe not so, because we have the National Competitiveness Council. That's the forum where business and firms, business firms and government are talking about reducing possibly business. What I'm missing is a similar forum between government and consumers. All along we've been talking about reducing burden on firms. We also should talk about improving regulatory quality as regulations affect consumers in the final analysis. And what else? Okay. If we go to the policy recommendations, this would need firm leadership and political will. In the case of Vietnam, no less than the prime minister and the highest leadership said we had to do a regulatory guillotine. It's the way we could attract more businesses and really perk up job creation in the country. So you need this one. Then maybe there's a need for a central oversight body that will oversee the implementation of the former IMS. We need this coordinator, somebody should be made accountable, be given the powers to coordinate these different agencies. I'm not saying that all regulatory bodies should report to one. There should be only one. Imagine the burden also if all every rule or regulation of Marina and data review would have to go through that that system. That took what? Simply congest everything, and before you know it, we even have far worse situation. What we're saying is that, okay, that probably each regulatory body should think in terms of making regulatory impact analysis, just to figure out how the regulation is helping or not helping consumers and firms. Review, and then those which are unnecessary, just eliminate them. You don't need five signatories. Maybe you need only one signatory. And that's what the local government has done. They're quite successful, cutting down the process from 34 days to just 8 days, and probably next time 5 days and a half. With automation and use of ICT, probably we can really cut down. You can say a lot more about this, but we'll hear from the other agencies. We just go to the final set of policy recommendations. We need to build capacity in undertaking RIA and formulating regulatory impact statements. In fact, we'll be sending researchers, PIDS researchers, to let's say to that. Sorry, my research associate to the seminar on how to estimate regulatory burden, because the way to convince regulators, politicians, leaders to cut down regulation will be to show the burden. We have to quantify. Hindi pwede sabihin mabigat itong regulasyon, dapat tanggalin. Gano'n kabigat? That's relative. So we need to do the numbers. And that's what we want. We will do at the ideas. Then, we need to probably review, again, whole mandate and stock of regulations. The stock. Marami na yun. To reduce regulatory burden. Do a regulatory utility. And involve more private sector and media, especially, highlighting the effect of improving regulatory quality and coherence. Not trumpeting the bats, but saying that, well, in those agencies, in those governments, local governments, which have reduced regulatory burden, this is what happened. the list of business registrations and renewals in Quezon City, we compared a before and after. That's a rough indication that maybe the reform has worked because you have more establishments registering their businesses in the city. It's a lot easier to do business now. And finally, this is self-serving because PIDS is a research institution. We say we should really intensify our efforts in conducting impact assessment studies, especially those bearing on regulations, and I take this opportunity to make a plea to the authorities to increase the resources made available to PIDS. Thank you very much.